Good morning. We miss you again this morning. I'm sure we're just now live stream, and we're glad to have you with us this morning. And hope you have a blessed day and a blessed morning. And this morning is Sunday before Veterans Day. And I know we have two here, I think, that are veterans this morning. And we just want to tell you that we thank you and appreciate what you've done for us and your sacrifice you gave, your time and your life, and being a veteran. And we just want to thank veterans everywhere. And I was not in the military, but I had a lot of family that were. I had five uncles in World War II, I think I told you before, one time. And they all came home safe. I had another uncle who was in Korea. I had several cousins in the military, in the Air Force, in the Army, and different things. So I've had a lot of family that's been in the military. And we've got friends that's been in the military and people I know right today that's in the military. So we really appreciate your service, and we just want to let you know how much we do thank you and appreciate you this morning. If you have your Bible today, we're going to start out in the book of 2 Samuel, but we'll get there in just a minute. But what I want to talk to you about this morning is what's in your hands. Do you look in your hands and say, well, I don't have anything in my hand right now, but that's not necessarily what we're talking about, what's physically in your hands at this moment, but what's in your hands. In everyday life, we have these experiences, and you've experienced times when you don't know how you're going to make ends meet. You know, you say, well, I look at my checkbook and there's nothing there. You know, and I've got these bills, and I've got this situation, I've got something I need over here, and I don't see any way it's going to happen. I don't see any way it's going to be taken care of. But sometimes God wants to show us things during these times and show us His power, what He has, and the blessing that He wants to be in your life. So have you ever experienced times when the challenge was too big? You say, God, there's just no way I can do this. I read this a long time ago, and I've tried to take this to heart. Is if it's big enough for me to do it, and I don't need God, it's not a godly thing to start with. If it's bigger than I am, and it's something that there's no way I'm going to accomplish it without God, God is in control when God wants to take care of it. There's a lot of situations like that. If you start getting in ministry and you start looking, God, here's what I'd like to do, but God, you know I can't do it. Just like during church, I told God when we started this, God, I can't do this on my own. If without you, it's not going to accomplish anything, nothing will be done, nothing will happen, because in myself, I cannot do this. But if I follow in your footsteps, Lord, then we can take care of it together, because you can show us what you need to do. You can help us get through it, and we can see this accomplished. And you wonder how you're going to get those things done? It's through God. That's how we're going to get it done. All right? So do you realize, as a child of God, the Bible tells us we walk by faith and not by sight. We're not going by sight. So we're not looking at the things always that we can see, but we're looking at the things of God, that what we necessarily can't see, how it's going to happen, how it's going to take place. But we know God said do it, and we know God's going to be with us because He told us He would. So we've got to look at God and say, God, how are we going to get this accomplished? So if by faith we can see what God's placed in our hands, then no matter how small, we can still see God move. And we can say, well, there's no way I can take this dollar and it go around the world. Well, I was looking at some stuff on the internet talking about people, and it was a ministry thing, and they were talking about, and this one lady had started her own business, and she was making 73 cents a day. God was blessing her in the place she was in. God knows what He's doing. God knows how to take care of His people. And God gives us things that she was using the talent that God had given her to open this store. And it was just a little hole in a wall with a cloth curtain in front of it. But she had a successful business in the place she lived by doing that. And she was giving God the praise for it. So it's stuck. I told you Samuel, but we'll go there in a minute. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1. And you may have read the story of the Bible before, but it says, a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant fears the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be slaves. So we see here that one of the sons of the prophets died. His wife, like the wives of most of those prophets, when they died, they were left penniless. They didn't have any income. They didn't have anything to come into the house. And his creditors demanded their money. Well, if you didn't have the money to pay, then they were determined that if she did not pay, that they were going to take her sons as slaves or servants to pay that debt back. All right, she came, as we will see, to Elisha, who was now the head of the school of the prophets, and begged for relief. So she came there and she said, I've got to have some relief. I don't want my sons to go into slavery. I don't know what to do. You know, my husband was a man of God, and I really need your help. So let's go on to verse 2. It says, so Elisha said to her, what shall I do for you? So he's listening to all this, and he's hearing what her need and what she needs. And sometimes we want to fix stuff for people. You ever been in that boat? And I just thought of this story, but there was the church we attended, Zion Family Ministries. There was a homeless man who came to church one Sunday morning, and he came there, and all of our folks in the clothes closet there, and all that kind of stuff. So if you need clothes, go to Zion Family Ministries. And Wise, there are certain days they do that, and they post it on Facebook, food and different things. But anyway, this gentleman shows up on Sunday morning. He comes in there. He's got two shirts with his whole belongings in the head, wrapped up in these shirts, and a thing with some papers in it. Well, all he asked for was copies of those papers. But our folks, and me included, we went into emergency mode. We're going to help this guy. All right, we go to Walmart, buy a backpack, we get the advice. New belongings and different things like that. They go to the back, find him some place, and he starts culling this, that, and the other because it's something in his life that he cannot use. So that's why with Elisha, you need to know what the need is. What would you have me to do for you other than you trying to anticipate what somebody needs? They may not need, like for him, we had food and we're giving him food. He said, I can't eat that. I've got diabetes and I can't take this and I can't take that. You know, and different things. So we're in emergency mode trying to help somebody, which is a good thing. But sometimes we just need to know, what do you need? What do you need? So Elisha said to her, what shall I do for you? Tell me what you do. Tell me, what do you have in your house? What do you have? And listen to the way this lady says this. And she said, your maidservant has nothing. So she automatically goes into this mode. You know, I'm penniless, I'm broke, I have not one single thing in my house. But then she goes on to say, she goes into the very thing of, woe is me here, I have nothing. And it says, in the house, but a jar of oil. So what's in your hands? Mosaic law gave the right to claim the person and the children both of the debtor who could not pay. So we look at that, and she's concerned, and she's seeing things. I've got an immediate need here, and she's seeing it as a worrisome thing, and that they might serve in this master until the year of Jubilee. And if you study that, that's when all the debts were forgiven. But up until that point, her kids and possibly soon could have been could have been slaves to pay this debt back. So it's looking how she asked him. She said, not as having resources. I don't have anything. I don't have anything, she says. No job skills. I don't have, I can't sew. I can't cook. I can't do this, that, and the other. I don't have any, can't be a secretary down here somewhere. I can't, use a shovel, nails, things. I don't have any skills. So I actually have nothing. And she says, your maidservant has nothing in the house. And she's telling him this. And she answered in a position, again, of lack. And my husband's dead, and I have nothing. And what am I going to do? She's just her hand wringing her hands. I don't know how I'm going to accomplish this. But she finished the statement with, but a jar of oil. I have a jar of oil. Everybody knows God can work with anything that we have. He can take whatever, what seems nothing to us, and make something out of it, just like he did with your life. A lot of people may have thought you were nothing. But when God took the place in your heart, then it became something. And that's what he does with this lady, as we go on to see. Verse 3 through 5 says, then he said, go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you should shut the door behind you and your sons. Then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones. So it's about like this bottle of water. She's got, I don't have make the jar all what she had, but it, I'm assuming not very big, but say this bottle of water right here. So she goes in there, she does what he says. So verse 5 and 6 says, so she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons and brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, there is not another vessel. So the oil ceased. So whatever size vessel she had, she poured, and she poured. Looking in it, she poured, and she poured. And she looked in it, and she poured, and she poured. And all these vessels that had been brought, and it was not just a few, it says, but many, many vessels. But every time she poured, she set that back down, it's still full. She poured, and she poured, and it's still full. God supplied, but listen here, said, when he said, there is not another vessel, so the oil ceased. Earth was still full, along with all the others, but it was not running over on the table. It was exactly what this lady needed to take care of it. So we see the miracle of God performed in this instance, and using that widow with what she had in her hands, God used that to bless her, take care of her, supply her need to the exact amount that she needed to live. And she may have not have prospered, had a big bank account because of this oil, but she had exactly what she needed for her and her sons to pay their debts and to live and not go into slavery. So when her need was completely filled, the scripture said, so the oil ceased. All right, if she had more vessels to fill, I think the oil would have kept coming. I think it would have kept coming if she had brought a tanker truck in there and said, I'm going to pour it out of this. It would have filled that tanker truck up. If that's what God had in mind, it would have continued to flow until she did not have a need. Because God has an endless supply of the very things we need. He took care of her, and he'll take care of you today, just like he took care of this woman in that particular instance. It is the kind of, like Elisha's kind of like the old saying you may have heard at some point in time. It says you can give a man a fish and feed him for a day, or you can teach a man to fish and feed him for a lifetime. So you think about that. You can give somebody something, but you can give them a skill that they can use over and over and over to feed themselves and take care of their very needs. And that's what happened here to Elisha. So verse 7 says, then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest of it, on what's left over. So she had way more than nothing in her hands. When she started out, she said, I have nothing but a jar of oil. But that jar of oil is exactly what she needed, and the jar of oil was life-sustaining in her particular instance. What do you have in your hands? What do you have that God can use to bless you, or maybe even bless others with, as we'll see? All right, let's look at another person who experienced this. Moses is in the conversation with God about being Israel's deliverer. He's going through all this process, and you know, he's standing there in a burning bush that's not being consumed, but he's still questioning God. So you say, well, I hate to question God. We all do. But you think about some of the prophets and some of the different people when they spoke with God, and his power was right there in front of them. They still questioned him. So let's go to the book of Exodus, chapter 4. Verse 1 and 2 says, then Moses answered and said, but suppose they will not believe me or listen to my voice. Suppose they say, the Lord has not appeared to you. Here you come. Why should we believe that? So the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? So God asked him that specific question. And he said, a rod. So to most people, this was a simple shepherd's staff, or maybe a shepherd's crook that they was used to tend sheep, because that's what Moses was doing at the time on the backside of the mountain for his father-in-law Jesse. But until God steps in, something simple becomes something extraordinary. All right, verse 3 and 4, and he said, cast it on the ground. So he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it. And I can imagine I'd be doing the same thing. If I threw it down and it became a snake, I'm going to start jumping back because I don't like snakes. So if you want to come to this church, don't ever worry about us handling snakes because we ain't doing it here. All right? So then the Lord said to Moses, reach out your hand and take him by the tail. right? And he reached out his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand. So it changed back to its original state. Verse 5 says that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Just go down to verse 20. Says that, and here's where it changed. It changed from just a rod to the rod of God. It says in verse 20, it says, then Moses took his wife and his sons and sent them on a donkey. And he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. So it was the same rod that he had tended sheep with, the same rod that he had thrown down and turned into a serpent. When he grabbed it by the tail, it became a rod again. And it was the same rod that he took with him that now became the rod of God. God is the great shepherd. He's the one that takes care of us, and he was going to lead his sheep out. So what was in the hands of Moses became called the rod of God, and this was used multiple times by Moses. If you read on down through the story of the Israelites as they went through the desert and going to the promised land and performed many miracles using that rod, because it was the rod of God. He had taken what was in Moses' hands and turned it into something miraculous. And Moses made excuse after excuse as to why he could not complete the task God was asking him to do. He went over it and over it. God, I can't do this. But it's amazing how we think we can accomplish anything until it's something God asks us to do. Have you ever noticed that? Man, I can take you, give me a hammer and some nails and a few different things like that, I can build a house. God tells you to do something simple like witness to somebody that's standing over. God, I don't know if I can do that. Have you ever noticed that? If it's normal physical things, we're all for it. But whenever it comes to the things of God, we back off and say, God, I don't know if I can do that or not. God, I can't do that. God, I don't know if I can trust you that much. Why? I wonder, why is that? Because the enemy comes in and tries to steal what God puts in our heart. He tries to steal the seed. And he's continually doing that. The Bible tells us he's out to steal, kill, and destroy. All right? In Moses' hand was a simple rod, a shepherd's crook, and God used it to deliver a nation. He used what was in Moses' hands to do that. What do you have in your hands that God can use? Still have doubts? Let's look at another one. Okay, and there's more than just the four we're going to look at here today. But 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 38 and 39, and we're looking at David, and David's getting ready. He's down there seated and taking food to his brothers the years of Goliath, and you know how the story goes. And it ends up, David says, you know, I can take care of this if you give me just a minute. And God chooses David, and Saul chooses David to fight against Goliath. But it says, so Saul clothed David with his armor, and he put a bronze helmet on his head, and he also clothed him with a coat of mail. So he's got all this weight. We're talking about a young boy here. So, and if you remember the story of Saul, he was a head taller than everybody else. So he's a big guy, but he's putting his armor, because he's afraid to fight Goliath, he's putting his armor on his little kid. All right, so David fastened the sword to his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, I can't even walk with this stuff on, for I have not tested them. So David took them off. So many times we see the things other people have in their hands and think, boy, if I only had that in my hands, if I only had that armor, I could take care of this. If I only had their money, I could do this. If I only had all the things that they have, you know, their knowledge or their skills or whatever. But God has given each one of us something in our hands, something he can use, to reach a world. It's in your hands. You just have to realize it's there, and you have to realize it may not be something that you think. It may not be a PhD, but God can still use it. It may not be things like that, but God still can use it. But David proved what was in his hands. He said, I know what it is. What's touched by God was greater than any armor made. All right, 1 Samuel chapter 17 and verse 40. It says, then he took his staff in his hands. All right, and he chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook, and put them in a shepherd's bag, and in a pouch which he had, and he sling in his hand, and he drew near the Philistine. So we see David had two items in his hands. He had a staff, just like Moses had, with the rod of God, and he had his sling, or a simple shepherd's tool. He had that with him. Do you have giants in your life? Do you know other people that may have giants in their life? What do you have in your hands that God can use to defeat those giants? He will not send you to somewhere without something to fight back with. He will not send you to do something, but he will give you the tools to do it. That's the way God is. So the staff similar to that Moses had was generally, as you read about it, was about 6 foot long and crooked on the end. And it was made of peeled vine branches and those kind of things back in the day. It was used for climbing, it was used for walking, beating down bushes, and rescuing sheep that had fallen into the pit. The sling, it was generally made of leather or maybe wool, hair, or other items that was woven together to make that. And it had a wider middle to hold the stone that was going to be put in there. The sling was used by the shepherds to keep wild beasts away from the flock and to keep the sheep from straying. You see a sheep going over through there just running, slinging, and it in the butt, thinking back over here. You know, it's going to learn something. So stones thrown could pierce helmets and shields because they had so much force against them. And Lisa and I were talking on the way down here this morning, and we were talking about how those stones and stuff work. But you think about a smooth stone versus a jagged stone. One thing is a smooth stone is going to be more accurate because it can go where it's at. You don't see jagged bullets in a gun. They're smooth made so they can pierce through the air and get to the target. And it's just like we were talking about that this morning. If you get a jagged stone, you throw it, it's going to not go as fast. It's not going to go as hard because it's going to have more resistance. Sometimes that's the way we are in life when we start thinking about the things God's given us and what God's using in our life. He has to smooth out our rough edges so we can do what he needs us to do. He smooths it out through the Word of God. He smooths it out through teaching if we're willing to be taught. And he uses these things to smooth us out, that he can use us as something that can be propelled out into the world, and we can defeat the enemy and defeat the giants in our life. All right? And these guys were so accurate with these particular slings. And if you've ever seen one, somebody brought Nathaniel one, our son, went back from Israel several years ago. And it's just a pouch about this big. And it's got a piece of rope on one side, a piece on the other side. It's just like this right here, and you turn it loose. And this is how accurate these guys were. Judges chapter 20, verse 16 says, the men of Israel could sling stones at a hair breadth and not miss. I'm not that accurate with a gun with a scope on it. But they could do it with a sling. So you think about that. So David and his fighting Goliath was still just being a shepherd. He was still just doing the shepherd thing. He had his shepherd staff, he had his sling, and his stones, but he was protecting the flock of Israel from the wild beasts with what he had in his hands. He was protecting them from the giant Goliath with that sling and with that staff. He was just still in his shepherd mode, doing what he did as a shepherd. So let's look at one more. Matthew chapter 14 and verse 13 says, when Jesus heard it, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the multitudes heard it, they followed him on foot from the cities. Verse 14, it says, when Jesus went out and saw the great multitude, he was moved with compassion for them and healed their sick. Verse 15, when it was evening, his disciples came to him, saying, this is a deserted place, and the hour is already late. Send the multitudes away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. Verse 16 through 18 says, but Jesus said to them, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. All right, we got 5,000 people, men, not including women and children. He says, you feed them. And they said to him, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, bring them here to me. Verse 19 says, then he commanded the multitudes to sit down on the grass. And he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he blessed and broke, and gave the loaves to the disciples, and the disciples gave to the multitudes. Verse verse 20 and 21 says, so they all ate and were filled, and they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments that remained. And now those who had eaten were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. So I want you to see a similarity here between the disciples that were following Jesus, right with him every day, seeing all the miracles that he performed. He just healed all these people. But look at what they said. They were just like this woman with the oil. We have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. So they're looking in a place of lack too. So what the disciples did not realize was that Jesus' hands, the possibilities were endless. Now I can kind of see them, and I can kind of see the situation they're in. We got all these people. We got 5,000 people. And we were having this conversation coming down this morning. I said, can you imagine if we had 5,000 people right here, plus women and children? We said, okay, we're going to break for lunch. You go get something to eat. And they go downtown to Duffy. Is that going to work out? You think about these little towns, these little cities in Jerusalem and surrounding areas there. Could they have handled 5,000 people going to lunch at one time? Okay, let's move on up a little bigger. Let's go up to Norton. Or over here, Kent City. Could they handle 5,000? I don't think Kingsport could handle 5,000 people, plus women and children. You start calculating it out, say half of those men were married. All right, so that gives us, what, 7,500 people. Then if all those married couples had one child, it gets us up to about 10,000, if my math's right. So all these people flood Kingsport, Tennessee, the whole dry cities. 10,000 people running here at one time to get lunch. What time are they going to get back to the rest of the preaching? You talk about all-day meeting and dinner on the ground. It's going to be all-day meeting because by the time they get back, it's going to be daylight's going to be gone, and we're going to be preaching in the dark. So you think about those things. So I can see their stance and what they're talking about. But they did, even though they were with him all the time, many, many times, the disciples did not really realize the power that Jesus had. So Jesus knew the situation, but he knew his Father in heaven would supply all of his needs. So he told the disciples, bring them here to me. Bring it over here. Let me have it. And when you feel overwhelmed because you have a task at hand and you say, God, I can't do it, we're going to have to do something else. Take it to Jesus because he knows exactly how to handle whatever you need and whatever the situation is, to the point that not only you are filled with what you're having, with what's in your hand, but you have enough to also take care of the multitude also. You say, God, I really need your Spirit in my life. Well, God's going to give you his Spirit. He's going to put his Spirit inside you. But he's also going to give you enough that you can share it with others. And you can share it with the world that they can see that they need Jesus. And we can, and they can go where Jesus needs them to go. And they can do what Jesus needs them to do. And they can share it with somebody else. And it begins to multiply and multiply and multiply. And Philippians 4 and verse 19 says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. God can take care of it. God will take care of it if we put whatever is in our hands and we let God use it and take care of it. You may have read these statements before at some point in time, talking about these things in our hands. A basketball in my hands may be worth about $30. But you put that basketball in the guy's hand named Michael Jordan, and it's worth millions of dollars. Just because of what he can do with it, because it was put in his hands. Large stones in my hands probably just in the way. But you put them in the hands of a skillful artist, and it becomes a great statue. Because in their hands, they can take that and turn it into something great. Dirt and clay in my hands generally makes a mess. But in God's hands, it made man. From the dust of the earth, he tells us. All right, nails in my hands may build something useful, but nails in Jesus' hands made a way for all mankind to be saved. What's in your hands? What's in your hands? You know, we hear the Austin commercial all the time. Are you in good hands? Well, we're in good hands, in the hands of God. But what's in our hands that we can use to build the kingdom of God? God's blessed you with many talents and things that you have, and even things you may not see that you have. You may be like the woman with the oil or the disciples. You know, this is all I've got, God. What in the world can you do with this? God, this is all I know. What can you do with this? God can take things that you think are simple if you can use them, he says, to confound the wise. He can take those things and make something great because of what's in your hands. If you have in your hands the very thing you need to be successful in whatever God asks you to do, whatever he wants you to do, you have the talent, you may have the education, you may have the spiritual gifts and skills. Don't sell yourself short, because with God on your side, all things are possible. So how many know that when you're down to your last minute, you're down to your last dime, your back's against the wall, as you've heard all these sayings, you don't see the light at the end of the tunnel? I can tell you right now from experience that God's always on time, and he will come through for you if you have the faith to believe him. We've got to put it in his hands, and we've got to believe what he tells us. You think about that woman with that oil, and Elisha says, you go borrow all these vessels, and you pour into them. And she turned around and said, well, if that's all he's going to do, I'm just going to go back to the house and tell the guy to come get my son. That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard of. God may not always give you something that seems like you would say, how in the world is this going to happen out of this? Because God knows what he's doing. He knows exactly what he takes. And just like with the five loaves and the two fish, you know, they're looking at this and they're looking at all these people. They look at the bread and the fish and they look at all these people and they're going, Jesus, we really believe you and we're really following you. But, you know, you've been out here to son a lot longer probably you should have. But God knows what he's doing. Same thing with Moses and the staff. He says, this is all I've got is the rod of God, and this is going to lead all these people out of Egypt, and it's going to cause the kings to bow and say, take them out of here and leave. But it did. David walks up to a giant that's probably almost twice his size, and all he's got is a staff in his hand and a sling and 5 foot smooth stones, and we've got a whole army back here that won't even try to tackle this one guy. But God knows what he's doing. He takes those simple things if we'll just believe him. So just like he did for the widow, and just like he did for Moses, and just like he did for David and the disciples and many, many others, and just like he may be able to say, hey, I can tell you what he's done for me. God can take things that if you'll give it to him and put it in his hands, whatever he's given you in your hands, and he can use that for great mighty things. The question today is ask God, you know, show me what's in my hands. Show me what I have that you can use, that you can change lives for the kingdom of God. My life and the lives of many others. I can be a shepherd like David and try to heal people 5 times and get them out of their lives. What can I do to help them? What can I do for people that need something and they need oil? They need something that's going to be continuous, that's going to help them out. What can I do, Lord? What can I do to take care of these situations? Because you've given me something. You don't leave me with nothing. But you put something in my hands that can be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom. And God, I'm giving it to you to use. And I'm going to turn my life over to you and let you use it. Will you do that today? Will you use what's in your hands? Let's pray. God, we thank you, Lord, today. Again, for we know you've given us things, Lord, that it may seem like to us it's just very, very minimal. Lord, but you give us stuff, Lord, not only to bless our life, but to also be a blessing to others and to be able to progress the kingdom of God. And Father, I thank you, Lord, right now that you'll start revealing to us what's in our hands that can be used for your glory. And Father, help us, Lord, to walk in that and to do that, Lord. And Father, even though we may seem small, Lord, help us to not question you, but to follow you. Lord, just like Moses, Lord, he could do all kinds of things, Lord. But when it comes down to doing the things that you ask him to do, it seemed too hard. But Lord, we know that you're with us. You're right beside us, and you'll help us to get through it. And Father, we pray, Lord, right now, that each and every one listening today and in this room, Lord, that you'll help us, Lord, to see what's in our hands that you can use for the upbuilding of your kingdom and help us to do that. And Lord, we know that, Lord, for you to use us, we have to be one of yours. Lord, we have to have given our life to you, Lord, and accepted you as our personal Savior for you to use us. We have to be one of your children. And Father, there may be many out there today that's very, very talented in different areas that you want to use and you want to touch their life today. And you're speaking to their heart right now that they can see, Lord, that they need you as their Savior. And we pray, Lord, today that you're speaking to them. as we pray today with them, Lord, I pray that you'd save souls today. In Jesus' name, amen. As we always do, we never want to end without giving you an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're watching online today, you need Jesus in your life to see Jesus perform these things in your life and to use what's in your hands. You've got to give your life over to Him. You've got to give it to Him. And to get your sins washed away and be on your way to heaven, you've got to give your life to Him. There's only one way. The Bible tells us, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody can come to the Father except by me. And what Jesus had in His hands, when we look at Him and what He did in our for us in our life, and we start thinking about all the things that's in all these other people's hands, that there's nail prints in Jesus' hands. That's what's in His hands, all for our salvation. He went to the cross and was nailed to that cross for you and for me, so we, our sins could be washed away. And there was no other way it could be accomplished except through Jesus Christ. So if you don't know Him today, we're going to ask you to pray with us. We're going to ask you to repeat this prayer with us. You feel the Lord speaking to your heart today. Just pray, Lord Jesus, thank you that there's something in your hands, the nail prints, where you were nailed to the cross for me. I thank you that you'll wash my sins away. Forgive me. Set me on the right path. And today I'm going to start worshiping you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. We'd love for you to join us here at Journey Church. If you can come in person, we have plenty of room. And we're doing the two services at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. So there's plenty of room, plenty of social distancing. We'd love for you to be here in person if you can. If not, continue to join us online. If you want to come to church, we're at 355 Cecil B. Quillen Drive in Duffield, Virginia. And let's go on the journey together. Thank you for being with us.